the topic of today will be representation theory of weighted in algebras.
If you look at G
G1 is a presentation over G0, it's just a standard representation. So that's going to be plus minus epsilon r. So we have immediately something new. The double root might be root again, right? So those are all roots. They are not isotropic, of course, because this is just an abnormal basis. And the double root in this situation, the double root is again a root. So really, this is like the when you look at the classification of root system, if you drop the assumption that your root system is reduced, so what you get here is really the system we see.
Vera, why epsilon I delta j is delta I j? Epsilon I delta j is delta I j.
Oh, zero, sorry. That's my mistake. This is, sorry. Where are we? Sorry. So, the next thing which we want to do if we have the root system is triangular decomposition. Or, so we divide our roots in positive and negative. By drawing the hyperplane in the regular position, right? And so it's a geometric thing. You just divide it by the hyperplane. And then you can define simple roots. As an undecomposable root, exactly like you do in the usual case. Okay. So something new is happening here, that of course W is a Y group of the root system delta zero. It acts on the whole root system, on H star and on the whole root system, in the same way as before, but not all. Bases are, so not all bases can be obtained. By application of Y group. So still, if I fix some base of the system of simple roots.
So then you probably preserve delta 0 and delta 1.
Yeah, yes. X on delta preserves delta 0 and delta 1.
But the base is not necessarily. You can have elements in delta 0 and delta 1.
Yes, let me again, yes. Well, how would it be? Let's take the example of delta 2. So before I write it down, let me just say that you have, according to this, you have a triangular decomposition, G, which was M minus plus A, plus M plus, where M plus minus. An importance of algebras generated by, spent by positive or negative root cases, by this. So we also can define the Borel subalgebra as H plus M plus. And so we know that in the classical case, the Borel subalgebra is a conjugate. And on the terms of root system, that means that you start with one base and you can get any other base. So the Y group is transitive on the second base. That's not happening in the super case. And here, let me just give you an example. So I can, so it is clear that in this case I have epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 2, and I can order them, and each order them gives you the new base. So I can start with base epsilon 1 minus epsilon 2, epsilon 2 minus delta 1, delta 1 minus delta 2. Or, for example, I can take epsilon 1 minus delta 1, delta 1 minus epsilon 2, epsilon 2 minus delta 2. So those are four bases. However, the well group here is just Sn cross Sn, so it permeates only epsilons and deltas, right? So it's pretty clear that there is no linear action which maps this system to this system. Because if you look here, I have three odisotropic roots in my base, and here I have one even root and two odd, sorry, two even roots and one odd root in my base. There is a little bit more about type of roots I should mention. So we know that in the classical case for finite dimensional semi-simple algebras, if I pick up G alpha, G minus alpha, and their commutator which lies in the Cartan, that spans the Sartus algebra. And this is, of course, still true if my alpha is an even root. In particular, alpha is an zero. And so, and again, I have just a result of some algebra. But if alpha is odd, then I have two different cases which I should separate. Alpha is not zero, then G alpha commutator with G alpha is not zero as well, because this is a super commutator and it's symmetric, so it is not zero. And if I start building, picking up positive space, negative space, and H alpha, I also must have a root 2 alpha. Minus 12. So I get something five-dimensional. And this is again a superalgebra which we know, which we already discussed. This is the smallest simple superalgebra, OSP 1, 2. So in this case, this spans OSP 1, 2. I'm going to move it a little bit up. So the third case, alpha is odd and isotropic, and then G alpha, G minus alpha, and H alpha, then a three-dimensional subalgebra, which is not simple and which we also discussed last time, and which is analog of the Heisenberg, if this is SL 1, 1. So if one, what one can do now, if I look, so you can build something like a Dynkin diagram in this case as well. So as it actually also was done in an original paper by Victor, and he represented each of the simple root by nodes. This one, whiter node, corresponds to even root. This corresponds to odd root, which is not isotropic. And this corresponds to the odd root, which is isotropic. And then here, if you want to go back to this example here, and draw the diagrams. This is the first diagram. And this is the second one. So we're talking about diagrams, and then of course we can define the Cartan matrix.
So the same algebra is two different diagrams.
Exactly, then I'm going to comment on it. Yeah. So you see, you can start with Cartan matrix. And then they satisfy this relation which I finite dimensional superalgebra from the classification. You pick up any base, you pick up cartel matrix, and you do Kamut-Smoothe super algebra. Of course, you end up with a simple Lie super algebra, but not always, because in the case of PSL and N, your cartel matrix is going to be has Courant 1, and therefore, when you start building it, you automatically recover the central extension. So maybe just do one more thing. For the first system, I'm going to write down the Cartan matrix for PSL22. So here, the Cartan matrix looks like this. Here is my Cartan matrix, which is associated to this. And so you see that it is dependent, so the rows and columns are risk is not too much. So of course what I can do, I can also look at this system and get another Cartan matrix. And so there is a nice process to do it, which is kind of useful because as we see now, as Albert already told, that for different Cartan matrices, you can get isomorphic Kasmuthi Lie super algebra. Non-conjugate Borel's algebras. This leads to existence of many non-conjugate Borel's algebras. And when we do geometry next week, that will lead us to the existence of several non-isomorphic flat varieties, which are sometimes equally important, and we should consider all of that together.
Excuse me, but the extended dinking is unique, right?
I don't know if I have time, certainly not today. If I have time, I talk about the fine. So you can develop the theory of Kasmuthi, affine Kasmuthi super algebras as well. And many things which I'm going to do today also work for affine Kasmuthi super algebras. But somehow I decided to move in another direction. Extended are also good. So the thing I'm going to talk about is called odd reflection. And this is a simple process which allows you, starting with one dimpling diagram or with one base, to get all others. So suppose P is a base or set of simple rules. And alpha be an isotropic group. As we already know what the isotropic groups are, what the odd groups. So when we just by definition do the following, do a round of beta, but beta is another. Defined by the following rule, alpha and beta are not orthogonal, we put R alpha of beta is beta plus alpha. If alpha and beta are orthogonal, but beta is not equal to alpha, where R alpha of beta is beta, and it is minus alpha if beta is equal to minus alpha. This is a simple formula like this, but the point is, and I leave it as an exercise actually, which is a nice exercise. If I do this operation, then, and I start with the base, and it says very important that alpha must be inside the base.
Alpha only acts on the set of roots.
Only on the set of roots, yes. It's not a linear action.
beta is equal to alpha.
Beta is equal to alpha.
So here beta is in delta, not in pi.
No, beta isn't pi.
Only x on simple units.
Only x on simple units.
Beta is any alpha. Alpha is simple.
Alpha is simple, it's not one. This is the set of simple rules.
Beta is
simple. And beta is also simple. Beta is also simple. Because otherwise, you can extend it on a set of rules, but then you have plus or minus here.
But beta plus alpha is not simple root anymore.
No. But if I do it for all of them, then it becomes a simple root. So this is exactly an exercise. This is another way. So, and if alpha is not isotropic,
the definitional base is the same as in the classical case?
Absolutely, the same. You start with positive roots, pick up all the decomposable roots, this is a base.
But it's not a basis.
It is a basis in the lattice generated by roots.
No, isn't
this we consider Kac-Moody settings. Then it is. if you consider not PSL 2, but PSL 2 true.
Yes.
You just work with Kac-Moody settings.
Yes, okay.
And then it's all.
Okay.
So it is a base and a base.
Okay.
Well, so this is another base. But of course you can also do even usual regression, right? You can also, if alpha isn't P and alpha is not zero, you can do usual regression. Because if your root is odd, then 12 is a root and you still have a reflection. So you don't control reflection. And then, of course, you also get a base. This is also clear. So it's actually true for any alpha in pi. And the proposition, which also you can do now as an exercise, the proof of it, consists of two parts. So then we assume that G is a basic Kac-Moody. And then first, that if pi and pi prime are two bases, then pi prime can be obtained from pi by application of the sequence of ordered even reflection. And if you have two bases, pi and pi prime, are bases such that delta plus even roots of delta plus and even roots of delta prime plus are the same, then pi prime can be obtained from pi by application of only odd reflection. Sometimes we would like to consider all the bases, all the parets of algebras, which have the same even plot. That's kind of important. Yeah. So still, the point is that starting from one, you can get all others. So for example, if you work with gel 2-2, and what I performed here for you is just one good reflection. So you pick up the diagram on top, pick up the middle node, and perform the reflection with respect to this middle node. But you can continue this game, and you should get 6.
The other problem is the basic finite dimension.
Yeah. Otherwise, there are some results, more general results.
you write the other?
You don't need to say this.
Yeah, but it's for Rita's sake, because she, otherwise she's going to ask me every time what to do with this or to do. That's why I put Kasper.
I understand. No, can you write the other reflection in the example of GL2? You just said it. Can you write it?
You take R alpha and you take R minus alpha and you go back. So it's sort of evolution. Well, okay, in this case alpha is epsilon 2 minus delta 1. R alpha of epsilon 1 minus epsilon 2 is epsilon 1 minus delta 1. R alpha of alpha itself, epsilon 2 minus delta 1 minus delta 1 minus 2. And why this? This is just epsilon 1 minus epsilon 2 plus epsilon 2 minus epsilon 2. Here, make a alpha of delta 1 minus 2 plus epsilon 2 minus delta 1, which is alpha plus delta 1 minus 2. So, the exercise which I did 25 years ago and was very happy about it. Take this exception of superalgebra, start with one base and get all the other bases. Get all the bases. If I remember correctly, you should get five completely differently looking bases. Useful for different purposes. So you should really consider all of
them. I forgot what it means.
That one, it's, I remind you, that means that you have the grading such that this is to zero.
So sorry, this is, I'm sorry. So it's B0 is the Borel of G0, and G1 should be with brackets.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, is that? Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
And in the anti-distinguish, you take the opposite Borel as well?
Yes. It's not exactly opposite, you see? So you can get, you start with this one, and you can get this one just by the chain of all reflections.
Okay.
So you see at least that there is some nice combinatorics here, which is new. So let me now proceed to highest weight theory, which is the nature of thing. If you have a root decomposition, triangular decomposition, you can construct highest weight theory. And that was done originally, just in the beginning. It was already not the things which I'm going to talk before the break were actually mostly to Victor Katz. His paper 77 and 78. So we pick somebody
is one lambda, right? Not one b.
Is
it which is
one lambda?
Yeah. Three times.
Right.
Yes. This is about the uniqueness.
Up to 30.
No, I'm. Yeah, certainly, if special metrics is the general, but.
I work with SLMM when M is not equal to M. And then it's still unique.
No, no, but I'm talking about instead M.
Yeah, we do cosmotic case. Just
you
one.
Think, you think?
Yeah, listen. It makes sense to add the center of charge to our theory, right? So, let's fix it and forget. Not return to this issue again. Because it's, I don't think it's a really important issue. I mean, it's so. Well, yeah. And then I introduced Hegel, right? And this is called cosmology. And I'm going to define it as a maximal finite dimensional quotient of K. So you check yourself that it exists. Well, again, this makes sense only if lambda is not orthogonal, otherwise it's zero.
You said it's unique.
Yes, unique maximum finite dimensional quotient. Unique. Sometimes it's zero. That's what I say.
But it's zero when it's not integrable.
Yes, exactly. But it's still unique, right? Okay.
Yeah. Integral dominant, can you check it on even roots only?
No.
No, you need to check also odd ones.
If you want, I can tell about it as well. Yeah. I wanted to swipe it under the rug, but I will explain a moment how you check if lambda is. How to check when lambda is integral. Actually, one way to check is to use these odd reflections again. But first, I would like to say that if I work with this distinguished barrel for the type 1, so if I have this distinguished barrel, the situation is the following. I have even simple root. And one odd root. Let's call it alpha 0. And in this situation, for this barrel lambda is integral dominant, it's sufficient to check that lambda if lambda alpha check using 0 greater or equal than 0 for alpha 1. So the condition is exactly like in the usual case, ignoring completely the isotropic root alpha 0, which is in the base. Okay. But otherwise, I have to do something else in order to, I can calculate it. And conditions are rather complicated conditions. Conditions of that the weight is integral dominant in general are rather complicated. So they could be written down in each case. They depend on the choice of the parameter. These conditions arise when you choose the parameters.
So the condition is that lambda alpha I check is positive for simple roots, one odd simple.
So here is my even simple roots. So I have my finite.
Yes, series. So you check for the simple ones and.
That's all. So you check for this
one. Only for the even simple roots.
Only for the even simple roots.
You mentioned something about the isotropic. I'm sorry, I didn't get it.
So this guy is isotropic. This guy is isotropic.
Oh, you're doing the. A case only now.
It's only type 1.
I just want to say that in type 1 the matter is much simpler.
I see.
But I'm going to explain in a moment what to do in type 2.
Mm. So for type 1, just the simple.
Simple. can define category work for each variant. And because of this proposition about word reflections, you can actually check that definition depends. Only on a choice of
B0. In particular, integral dominants are not discrete. It's not a discrete set. It's not large.
Not always discrete set.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to talk about the Riemann dimension. Okay? A little bit later today. Okay? You are exactly right, because here, but maybe I should say about in this type 1 case and type 2 case, there is some difference. I should say difference between type 1 and 2 is as follows. In type 1, you look at the lattice generated by the Euclidea. Is a quorum 1 in Q root lattice. And then type 2 is a spiny index subgroup.
So,
y alpha 1 lambda generates a subvolume of the model. If lambda alpha is 1.
Which is key, I think that's a problem.
Yes, it's all different.
The definition.
Exactly. So that tells you what happens with the roots. And that tells you that all reflections act on the set of weights in a strange way. This is not a linear action. It's going to appear again when we look at the center of universal phenomena.
Excuse me, I have a question. Yes. So you have the fine odd reflection for isotropic roots only, right?
Odd reflection is by definition reflection
yes.
with respect to isotropic roots.
And then you claim that you can define the Weyl groupoid that will act transitively on the...
I can't define the Weyl groupoid.
You're right, that acts transitively on basis, right? That's what you said. Right?
Yes, but then if you want to define the whole Weyl group, you need to
so for OSP there are no odd reflections, right? No, I'm sorry.
But this is a good remark. This
no,
is
M. Generic OSP.
Generic OSP has a lot, plenty of odd reflections.
Okay, sorry. That
only
one doesn't.
This one
doesn't.
Has only one.
But I see. So the Weyl group, the regular Weyl group will act transitively for that, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so quickly, how to check if lambda is integral domain. So consider V0, the corresponding phi 0 base, root system, simple. So it has its beta 1 beta m. But those roots couldn't be, at least in type 2, couldn't be simultaneously simple with one base. Okay. So what I want to do, I take a base, so for any base, pi. I can choose.
Pi 0 is a base.
Huh?
Pi 0 is a base.
No,
pi 0 is a base in evil part. Pi 0 is a simple root system for delta 0. The trick is, you can't all put them in one base for the whole delta if you end up 2. But for any particular beta, you can find the base such that beta I is a base pi such that beta I is a pi. So then let's call it pi prime. Let phi be a region of fixed space. What's going to happen? I can do odd reflections to go to phi prime. So I have LB. And when I'm checking, if lambda prime beta I must be in z greater than 0. So you have to check that for each simple beta, I can find a base such that it's even if the simple root becomes a simple root for the prime, check this condition. And this is a finite algorithm because I know by this change of Bayes' formula, I know how to go from one simple model to another one. But the conditions I'm going to get are not sort of linear conditions. So if B is fixed, only for distinguished B, the integral is either integral dominant weights for the whole.
This should be better I check.
Better I check, yes, thank you. So in other cases, you have the picture like some cone and then some additional finite set of weights outside. That's a geometric picture for integral dominant. And I think now it's a good time to...
No, I have a quick question. So it is very clear that the condition that you give is necessary, because essentially you're just looking at the lattice from a different angle,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
But how do you know that this is enough, right? This is my doubt.
This is your exercise.
Ah, okay. Then it's easy.
Yeah, it's not difficult.
Eh? Not difficult. Okay. I'm glad to hear this topic.
It's not difficult. I think it's instructive to do it by yourself rather than I do it. Okay. So we talk about characters after the break, 7 minute break. Okay. So in principle, I think now what I'm going to do. I'm a little bit running out of time.
Sorry, what would you prove this last statement from that?
Actually, that tells me, if you just think a moment, if you have a non-trivial extension, it can find dimensional modulus. There are weights must be in this fiber, because the central must act at the same eigenvalue. And that tells me that I do not have any extension of this module with any other finite dimensional module. It might have self-extension, but it's easy to show that there's no self-extension. Okay? So I'm saying that if lambda is typical integral dominant, then the lambda is projected in a category of finite dimensional generalizations. So I just want to formulate one remarkable theorem, which I'm not going to prove, but it's good if I formulate it at least. Maybe I'm going to prove it later. I don't know yet. It's a little bit stronger than the formula, Kurzweil formula, and you can deduce, of course, Kurzweil formula from this theory, although you can get much easier proof. So I have now a notion of a typical central character, right? That's the one which fiber has only finitely many points. So this theorem, done independently by Penkov using geometry and Marie Galilik using only algebra. Suppose chi is a typical central character. We have some non-degeneracy conditions, which I don't want to talk now about. Conditions for type 2, not for type 1. So let us consider reduced algebra. Let's say U chi of G will be U of G. Quotient by the thing that Sasha considered here. Take the ideal of central character, generate the ideal of the object. So that exists a central character, chi zero of z of g zero, such that this new universal Hamiltonian algebra U chi of G is Marita equivalent chi 0 or g 0. And in this way, this additional conditions certainly true if I have integral domain. Those are some regularity. So moreover, if I'm in type 1, this algebra is just a matrix algebra, this one. And so in this way, all the categorical property for typical characters can be reduced to even case. And so what we have to do, we should go to a typical word. And so what we are going to do next week, go to a typical word. And use some journal. Unfortunately, I wanted to start the typical case today and do German math, but a little bit slower than I thought. Thank you.